Good morning. Now that everybody's gotten their coffee and so forth, maybe we should begin. So let's open up with prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, as you provided leaders for your people Israel, we pray that you would also bless leaders of your people today. We pray for all pastors and others who work in the church that they might point the way to Christ for your people and bring them the good news of forgiveness and life. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, last year when we started 1 Samuel, after we did some introductory stuff, we kind of made it, I think, through the end of chapter 6. Really, I don't know who divided the chapters, but 7-1 really goes with chapter 6. This year we want to start off with chapter 7, verse 2 is where we're going to start. And this particular section of Samuel tells us about Israel's acquiring a king. You'll remember last year we talked about the Ark of God, how it was captured, and the problem that Israel was having with the Philistines. In chapter 6, Samuel, the prophet, prays for God's people when they are attacked by the Philistines and they get victory over the Philistines. But the Philistines are kind of, at this point in time, the big threat to the people of Israel. And so we pick it up kind of there in chapter 7 with the Philistine threat looming in the background as we hit the events of chapter 7. So let's plunge right into chapter 7 and let's look at the first 6 verses. So, someone want to read for us? So we're going to read 7:2 through 6. If somebody wants to be so bold as to do that, if you would.
It was a long time, 20 years in all, that the ark remained at Kiriath-Jearim, and all the people of Israel mourned and sought after the Lord. And Samuel said to the whole house of Israel, "If you are returning to the Lord with all your hearts, then rid yourselves of the foreign gods and the Ashtoreths, and commit yourselves to the Lord and serve him only, and he will deliver you out of the hand of the Philistines." So the Israelites put away their Baals and Ashtoreths and served the Lord only.
Okay, so we have this statement that Israel's lamenting after Yahweh, their God, right? Which is kind of a precursor to repentance. Samuel's the one that really calls them to repentance. He says, put away your other gods. And the problem that's been around since the era of the judges, and keep in mind Samuel is kind of the last of the judges. So the problem that's been around that entire era is Israel keeps falling into idolatry, worshiping the same gods as the peoples around them. And so Samuel has to say, do this, put away your gods, and serve the Lord your God with all your heart. Now that is probably a reference to Deuteronomy 6:4, which of course comes up again in the New Testament when Jesus talks about the greatest of the commands, right? Love the Lord your God with all your heart. Now, one of the interesting things about the use of heart is it's a little bit different in Hebrew than English. That is, when the Hebrew language uses the word about heart, it's not simply talking about emotions. When you hear that in English, you know, we attach emotions to heart, right? But in Hebrew, while emotions are not totally absent, heart also denotes thought. So, in some ways, it's equivalent to what we would say is mind. So when Samuel says, serve the Lord with all your heart, he doesn't just mean to be emotionally attached to God. He's also talking about in your thoughts. You're thinking about God, not about Baal, not about these pagan gods. But serve the Lord your God with all your heart then means that you're doing this consciously and you're thinking about it. Now, I don't want to say emotion is completely absent in the Hebrew word, in the Hebrew figure of speech. It's there, but it's not the strong word for emotional attachment. They just think about things differently with body parts. And so when and it says, Lord, love the Lord your God with all your heart, it's first and foremost talking about your thoughts. Okay, and then secondarily about the emotions that come along with those thoughts. When that's kind of flipped around in English. So Samuel's really telling them, you've got to change the way you're thinking about this. And Israel's problem usually was that they tried to have it both ways. They tried to worship the pagan gods, and they tried to worship Israel's God. And he's saying, no, you've got to think about this differently. Serve the Lord your God with all your heart means just that. You need what we would think of as kind of a change in thoughts and thought processes about how you're going to do this. Okay, you'll notice that Samuel summoned them to Mizpah. Now, Mizpah is an important place in Israelite history, and a number of important things happened there. It's about 8 miles north of Jerusalem, we think. We don't know for sure where Mizpah is, but modern Tel and Nasba is probably it. It's a hill north of Jerusalem, about 8 miles. And so this is near Samuel's homeland. Samuel lives in central Israel. And he summons them to this place where a number of important things happen. If you get out of concordance and look up Mizpah, you'll see that a number of things happen there. So sometime in this period, you'll notice I have the dates up here, 1069, 1049 BC. Somewhere during this period, he summons them there and says, okay, this is what you need to do. This is your problem. And you'll notice it comes right after the notice of the ark again. The ark was at Kiriath Jearim for a long time, we're told. This is after it was returned. Remember, it had been at Shiloh. It was in the tabernacle there. The Philistines won this victory after Israel took it out to battle, right? We read about that last year. Eventually, the Philistines decided they don't want any more of the ark anymore with all the things God had happening there. And so it was sent back and eventually settled at Kiriath Jearim in the land of Judah. And so finally, after a period of time of it being there, the Israelites come to Samuel with this as he summons them together and tells them they need to repent. Any questions there before we go on to the next set of verses? Well, my clicker's not working. We'll do it that way. Did we read about the water ritual? They poured out water? No. Is that the next part?
There were two more verses.
What?
There were two more verses.
Oh, read the other two verses then.
Then Samuel said, assemble all Israel at Mizpah, and I will intercede with the Lord for you. When they had assembled at Mizpah, they drew water and poured it out before the Lord. On that day they fasted, and there they confessed, we have sinned against the Lord. And Samuel was leader of Israel at Mizpah.
Okay, so the water ritual is not explained here. You notice the author doesn't bother to tell. I think he probably assumed his original readers knew what this was about. Unfortunately, we don't have any place in the Bible that explains what was going on here, but this probably had something to do with their repentance. The prophets often do things as symbols of something else. This is not unusual, and we see this in later prophets throughout the scriptures, where they act out something of significance. So this probably has something to do with their repentance, but what, we don't know. That translation said Samuel, what, led Israel or presided over Israel or something like that. Oftentimes, an older translation, it says he judged Israel. And this is the same word group that occurs in the book of Judges for what the judges did. This may imply that they hadn't been paying attention to Samuel before this, even though he was God's prophet. You know, this is the first time it's saying that Samuel judged Israel, that he led Israel. And so it may be that God had given them this prophet Samuel, but they weren't paying attention until this point. That's certainly pretty clear when they took the ark out. They didn't consult Samuel, right, when they took the ark out of the battle and it was captured. There's no mention of that. And so here it seems as if Israel's getting a little bit more serious about following God and his prophet. So at this point, they're ready for something else. Let's see what happens in here as they are at Mizpah. So, could somebody read verses 7 through 14 for us?
When the Philistines heard that Israel had assembled at Mizpah, the rulers of the Philistines came up to attack them. And when the Israelites heard of it, they were afraid because of the Philistines. They said to Samuel, "Do not stop crying out to the Lord our God for us, that he may rescue us from the hand of the Philistines." Then Samuel took a suckling lamb and offered it up as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. He cried out to the Lord on Israel's behalf, and the Lord answered him. While Samuel was sacrificing the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to engage Israel in battle. But that day the Lord thundered with loud thunder against the Philistines and threw them into such a panic that they were routed before the Israelites. The men of Israel rushed out of Mizpah and pursued the Philistines, slaughtering them along the way to a point below Bethkar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen. He named it Ebenezer, saying, "Thus far has the Lord helped us." So the Philistines were subdued and did not invade Israelite territory again. Throughout Samuel's lifetime, the hand of the Lord was against the Philistines.
Actually, and 14.
The towns from Ekron to Gath that the Philistines had captured from Israel were restored to her, and Israel delivered the neighboring territory from the power of the Philistines. And there was peace between Israel and the Amorites.
Okay, so notice that it's not explained why the Philistines show up. Two possibilities is one is this is just opportunistic that they noticed all Israel's gathered, they figured they might strike while they, you know, got all the leaders together at least at Mizpah. The other is that they're worried about Israel gathering to make war, and so they're might be a preemptive strike. We simply don't know. The author doesn't tell us. But notice that they beg Samuel to pray. Notice the difference in their attitude. Before, when they had trouble with the Philistines, they didn't consult anybody. They just decided to go out on their own, get the ark, take it out the battle, right? Now they consult with God's prophets. So you can see a sign of their repentance right away in that they go to Israel and they ask him, or go to Samuel and ask him to pray for them. Notice also the contrast here. The Philistines were afraid the last time when the ark came into Israel's camp. This time we're told that Israel is afraid. But Israel at least does the right thing and they ask Samuel to pray for them. And we get this interesting thing of Samuel therefore offering a sacrifice. A young lamb, we're told it was still nursing, so it's a very, very young lamb. And we're told in Exodus and Leviticus you could sacrifice a young lamb as long as it was at least 8 days old. So this was not something not permitted. It was obviously something that they could do. So Samuel takes this young lamb and sacrifices it to God. The sacrifices in the Old Testament, of course, are always begging on God for mercy and forgiveness. And so that's apparently what they're doing here and asking God would do this. And notice that the defeat of the Philistines is completely by what God does in verse 10. He thunders from the heavens. Okay? And it's only after that that Israel goes out and pursues the Philistines. So it becomes pretty clear to Israel, or at least it should be clear to Israel, that the victory is God's. It's not theirs. They only go out and pursue after God has really done all the hard work. He's done all the heavy lifting here. And the Philistines are routed before they even get a chance to attack. So we have this description of where they're chasing the Philistines. Now that's westward. The Philistines, keep in mind, are on the southwest coast. That's where their cities are, southwest coast of what is now Israel. And so the Philistines are fleeing westward, back towards home. And those places that are mentioned there are kind of on the way west. Okay, and eventually they end up with a place that they name at this time, Ebenezer, where Samuel sets up this rock. Well, Ebenezer means rock of the helper. Okay, Eben is rock, Ezer is helper. Ezer is like the name of somebody we know from elsewhere in the Bible, Ezra, whose name means helper. Okay, but of course, the rock of the helper is who here? Pardon?
God.
God, yeah, God is their help. And so this rock that Samuel sets up, which they call the rock in the place Ebenezer, is a testimony to God's help. And Samuel's trying to point them to the fact that when they abandoned God, they didn't have any helper. That these pagan gods were of no help to them because they don't exist at all, right? And this is why Samuel had to say, get rid of your pagan gods. If you really want God to help you, don't rely on gods that can't help, is what he's basically saying to them. And when he sets up this rock, he's reinforcing that thought. That if you look for trust in something, and trust in something other than God, it's going to fail. But God is your helper. And so this Ebenezer is intended to be a sign for Israel. Whenever they pass by it, they're to remember that God's their help. Now, of course, that's an old story, and that's true throughout the Bible and true throughout our lives, right? When you trust in something else, it doesn't work. And so the writer of Samuel here is trying to say to his readers, Ebenezer isn't just for these people back there, right? Pay attention to this. The fact that he notes this and tells us its name is his message to us. This is something easy to fall into, trusting anything else but God. And don't do it. The true help for Israel came when they repented and they trusted in God. They listened to his prophet Samuel, and God did all the work for them. So this chapter 7 and the defeat of the Philistines is rather important because it demonstrates to Israel that their problem with the Philistines, who were, you know, always during this era trying to impinge on Israel, invading Israel, that their only real help against the Philistines is going to come if God does it. Now the Philistines are going to... go ahead, George, before I...
It's all right. When you get done, then I'll...
Well, I was going to say the Philistines are going to remain a problem until they get a king who can deal with them. Okay, and this doesn't happen until 2 Samuel, about chapter 5 in 2 Samuel, when David becomes king. So the Philistines are going to be a problem for a while yet for Israel. And Saul will try to deal with them, but as we will see, Saul will not deal with them very well because Saul himself is not very faithful. And it's only until they get a king like David that the Philistines are going to kind of fade away as a threat. So there's a long learning curve for Israel, including learning curve for their king, who doesn't quite measure up, as we'll see.
What's the interjection there at the end of verse 14? And there was peace between Israel and the Amorites.
Yeah, the Amorites were east of the Jordan River, okay? Probably the Ammonites are who we're talking about, the people of Ammon, in what is now modern-day Jordan. At the end of the book of Judges, when we get to the judges Jephthah and Samson, we are told that the Philistines were attacking Israel from the west, and the Ammonites from the east. Now Judge Jephthah takes care of the Ammonites, and we read about that in the book of Judges. So, but the Philistines still haven't been taken care of. So this is kind of a play back to the book of Judges to say, okay, they're not facing any trouble on the east, but they still are facing trouble in the west. Another question?
Yeah, are the Philistines still reading about sisters of today's Palestinians?
Well, maybe. I mean, nobody has any direct lines. Probably some of those people over there, but there's been people in and out of that area for centuries, so there's a lot of mixed bloods. The name Palestine may indeed come from Philistine. Okay. But yeah, I mean, there are all kinds of historical movements between this period, obviously, 3,000 years ago and now. So yeah, probably some of those people are, but you know, nobody knows. The bloodlines have been mixed with all kinds of people coming through, Persians and Romans and Greeks and who knows what all over, and you know, Arabs and everything over the centuries. Anything else there? Well, this is important because it sets up Israel's continued problem with the Philistines, and is going to lead to their next request. So notice that the Philistines, we're told, are subdued for the rest of Samuel's life. And so here are some of the things that happened with the Philistines in the future. Saul and Jonathan attack the Philistines. Really, Jonathan does the hard work there. The Philistines' advance is halted by David's defeat of Goliath in chapter 17. And then only after Samuel's death will the Philistines again advance into Israelite territory. And this will be the defeat and death of Saul at the very end of 1 Samuel. So the statement that, you know, the Philistines were subdued during the lifetime of Samuel is true. It's not that they don't have conflicts with them. Conflict between Saul and Jonathan and the conflict with Goliath are on kind of the border between Israel and Philistine territory. But we're told they don't, you know, they're kind of subdued. They don't get to enter Israel. Well, they enter Israel again at Saul's death. Samuel's dead by that point. And they're very far up north in Israel. They're extending their reach way up into northern Israel. And Saul dies in northern Israel in battle. So there's a statement here that kind of looks forward to what's going to happen during the rest of Samuel's lifetime. Now keep in mind, Saul is going to become king, but Samuel's going to be around for much of Saul's reign. He's going to die, let's say, 7 or 8 years before Saul's reign comes to an end. Saul's reign probably lasts about 40 years, so Samuel's going to live quite a lot longer. But he's not, once Saul becomes king, he's not going to be the leader that God intends. He's going to have to step in several times because Saul doesn't do the right thing. But he's not going to be the one that God intends. Saul's going to be the one that God intends. So Samuel will be around yet for a while, but we're transitioning to Saul with this Philistine threat, and here God has subdued them. We're told in this section that Israel reclaims territory on its western frontier from Gath to Ekron. Now, Gath and Ekron are two of the five Philistine cities, so they get territory up near Gath, up near Ekron. These five Philistine cities are all on the coast, as I said, in what is now southern Israel. So Israel regains this land that they had previously had and that the Philistines had taken away as a result of this victory they get here. And then we're told peace with Ammon. And yours might say Amorites, it might say Ammonites. There's a textual problem here with people copying over the text. Even in Hebrew, Ammonite and Amorite look very similar. It was easy for the scribes who copied this over to confuse one with the other. But I think the best reading is probably Ammonites. They had peace with Ammon. But if your Bible says Amorites, that's not completely wrong, because Amorites is a wider term that includes Ammonites. So either way, it works. But the words are very similarly, it look very similar in both both words in Hebrew. So that's probably some type of scribal confusion over the years. The scribe copying it over accidentally wrote Amorite instead of Ammonite. But I think the better reading here is Ammonite. Some of your Bibles may say Ammonite instead of Amorite, or may have that in a footnote. Either way, they have peace on their eastern side. That's the point of that. Judges 10, if you go to Judges 10:7, I think that's the Jephthah passage that I have up here where the Ammonites have been a problem previously. Questions there? Okay, let's move on then. 7:15 through 17. Just three verses. Could somebody read that?
Samuel continued as judge over Israel all the days of his life. From year to year he went on a circuit from Bethel to Gilgal to Mizpah, judging Israel in all those places. But he always went back to Ramah, where his home was, and there he also judged Israel, and he built an altar there to the Lord.
Okay, so this era may have lasted about 12 years. The ancient Jewish historian Josephus seems to indicate it lasted about 12 years, and that seems about right when you try to figure this out. The places that are mentioned here that Samuel goes on his circuit. Now, his home is Ramah here. And so we're told he goes to Mizpah, Bethel, and Gilgal, and I got a question mark here because we're not exactly sure where Gilgal is. It has to be somewhere in this area. And so he does this circuit in central Israel. You know, it's north of the Dead Sea, Gilgal is. And so he's in central Israel, and he kind of rides this circuit, we're told, judging Israel. And so Samuel is kind of God's appointed leader. And he does more than just, you know, sit in a courtroom and judge. That Hebrew word that's translated judge is much wider than the English word judge, which just sounds like judicial stuff. He's not only making decisions in court cases, but he's also kind of doing all the administrative stuff that a leader would do for a people. The places here are important. Gilgal is the first encampment in the Promised Land when Joshua comes over into the Promised Land. There they encamp before they attack Jericho. Bethel is an important place. That's where God appeared to Jacob, Genesis 28, Jacob's ladder. right? And Jacob calls it Bethel, house of God, because he said, this was God's house and I didn't realize it after he had that dream. And then Mizpah, of course, where they recently had their victory. So the places that Samuel goes not only are in central Israel, which kind of makes it easier for people to come because they don't have to travel the entire width of the land, but they also are places that were important in God's dealing with Israel in the past. And then we're also told he judges at Ramah. Ramah is Samuel's hometown. Way back in 1 Samuel 1, when we first meet Samuel's father, we're told he was from Ramah. And so Samuel's still there, that's his hometown, and there we're told he erects an altar. So obviously Samuel is making sure that worship takes place for God at Ramah. Now normally you would say, well, wait a minute, aren't they supposed to do this at the tabernacle? But keep in mind the tabernacle was probably destroyed when Shiloh fell to the Philistines. We have no mention of the tabernacle for a long time until sometime in 2 Samuel. So maybe they rebuilt the tabernacle or something like that. But Samuel, as leader, organizes the worship there. Now Samuel himself, interestingly enough, is probably not doing the sacrifices. If you read carefully, you'll see that Samuel is not a priest. He's a Levite. He's from the tribe of Levi, but only the descendants of Aaron from the tribe of Levi can be priests. So there's probably a priest or priests there in Ramah doing the sacrifice. Samuel, though, seems to be kind of in charge of everything. He's the administrator. And so we'll see this again when Saul comes to Samuel. Samuel has an important part to play in sacrifices. And sacrifices are mentioned when Samuel and Saul first meet. So Samuel's kind of the administrator, but he's not doing the actual sacrificing. There's no mention of that, because he's a Levite and not a priest. You'll remember earlier on when he was young, he was serving under the high priest Eli in Shiloh at the tabernacle. But there again, it's never said he offered sacrifices. He sleeps in the tabernacle to make sure the lamp that's in the tabernacle never goes out at night. So he has responsibilities as a Levite in the tabernacle, but not the priestly responsibilities. So Samuel seems to take charge here at this point and becomes judge for maybe a dozen years. I think that's all I have on that. Yeah, we'll go on to 1-3, but any questions there before we do that?
What were the distances like between the...
You could walk them in a day or two, so they're not great distances. You're talking, you know, at that point, even if you wanted to walk from one end from the Mediterranean Sea to the Jordan River, at that point in Israel, you're talking maybe 25 miles. So you're not talking long distances. It's not like the United States. It's hard to judge, I guess, until you've kind of seen it. But I remember, a number of years ago, I taught a summer course at our seminary in Fort Wayne, and I had a man in the class who was from Denmark. Yeah, he was from Denmark. And he was saying he wanted to go out, I don't know, and visit somebody in Nebraska, and how long do you think it would take me to get there? Well, from Fort Wayne? It's going to take you, you know, you better give yourself quite a lot of time to drive to the middle of Nebraska, right? I said, you know, you might want to give yourself a couple days just to get there if you're going by car. And he looked at me and said, a couple days? He said, I can drive all the way across Denmark in a couple hours. You know, so I guess your context means everything. Because he looked at the map and he didn't know how far it was, and he just kind of figured the United States is like Denmark or something, I guess. And it's not. So we look at Israel and we go, well, how big is that, you know? Well, at that point, about that point in Israel, about 25 miles from the Mediterranean to the Jordan River. So there's not even 25 miles between any of those points.
When I was teaching, I'd always tell the kids, think of Milwaukee to the end of Chicago, the lakefront to Elgin.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's, yeah, it's not a very big area. You know, now, if you get into southern Israel, it's a little bit further across. You get further up northern, it's even narrower. So, you get up into northern Israel, maybe 20 miles, something like that, between, say, the Mediterranean Sea and Sea of Galilee. It's not a lot.
Thank you.
So yeah, you know, you could do it. You could even walk it if you had to, right? And my guess is many people did just walk it. They didn't ride an animal or anything. Any other questions about that? Okay. Well, finally, Israel decides that this system of judges that they've had for a long time, ever since Joshua's death, you know, and then they had judges like Othniel and Samson and Jephthah and all these others that are mentioned in the book of Judges, as well as Eli and then Samuel in the book of Samuel, they decide they don't want to live under this anymore. And so chapter 8 brings us to their request for a king. So let's read the first three verses.
And Samuel became old, and he made some of his judges over Israel. The name of his firstborn son was Joel, and the name of his second, Abijah. They were judges in Beersheba. Is it to four?
Yeah, to three.
Yet his sons did not walk in his ways, but turned aside after gain. They took bribes and perverted justice.
Okay, so Samuel gets old. He appoints his son as judges, Joel and Abijah. Okay, and interestingly enough, they're not doing it where Samuel is. They're doing it in Beersheba. Anybody know where Beersheba is?
Way south.
Way south. It's kind of usually considered the southernmost city in ancient Israel. When they talk about, just like we talk about from coast to coast, they talk about from Dan, which is they consider the northernmost city, to Beersheba, the southernmost city. So they're way down south. They're judging down there. Not under Samuel's direct supervision, right? And we're told they did not walk in his ways. They turned toward bribes and other types of dishonest gain. So Samuel tries an innovation here. He appointed his sons as judges, okay? Before this, judges were appointed by God. And the book of Judges makes this clear. There's no hereditary judgeship elsewhere in the Bible. Okay, so here's an innovation, and we see that even the great prophet Samuel is capable of making mistakes. Well, he appoints his sons judges, and it didn't work well. And Samuel's the only judge that does this. We have another example of this being thought of, and that's in Gideon's day, when the people come and say, you judge us and then your sons after you, and Gideon refuses to make it hereditary. Okay, so it's not that people haven't thought of this before, kind of a hereditary judgeship in Israel. It's just that it was rejected by Gideon when it was brought up. So Samuel actually does it. Now, Samuel's sons are interesting. We have two sons, and one of them is mentioned elsewhere in connection with his son, Heman. Heman becomes a Levitical singer in the tabernacle, and he's mentioned in 1 and 2 Chronicles. Actually, I think also in the book of Psalms, with connected with a couple psalms. Okay, so Joel is his son, Heman his grandson, and Heman is mentioned elsewhere. Abijah's just mentioned here and nowhere else. There are other people named Abijah, but this particular Abijah, as far as I know, not mentioned by name anywhere else. Okay, so Joel does mention to this son as a singer. So even though Joel is corrupt, apparently Heman is a very godly man and gets appointed by David to lead songs, one of the Levitical leaders of songs in worship of God. So Samuel's line will continue on in service to God well beyond his day. But we have this problem then with Samuel's sons being down Beersheba, out of his direct oversight, and taking bribes and doing other things. Now, of course, this is a theme we've seen elsewhere in the book of Samuel to this point. We saw Eli's sons, who were also corrupt, right? And when Eli's sons were corrupt, and the people decided to take matters into their own hands, we ended up with the Ark of the Tabernacle, right? Ark of the Tabernacle being captured. Here, Israel's also going to react, but it's not going to be by taking their own initiative. If one thing has happened here is they have repented, they know that they shouldn't just take initiative on their own. And so we can see somewhat of an improvement in Israel in that they come to Samuel, God's prophet, to come up with something else. Okay, so even though they may not have got it 100% correct, they're at least on the right track. They know to come to the prophet before they do anything anymore. So let's look at what these guys are doing. When they accepted bribes and perverted justice, these things are some of the worst offenses against God by officials mentioned in the Old Testament. Notice how often in the Old Testament accepting bribes and perverting justice are linked together. Okay, and then sometimes bribes, sometimes just perverting justice separately. But this is a big concern. Okay, the judges are indeed deciding cases. That's not all they do, as I mentioned earlier. But they are indeed deciding cases like in a court of law. And if you can bribe the judge, keep in mind they don't have a jury, right? The judge is deciding it all. So if you can bribe the judge, you can pervert justice pretty quickly. And so this is a big concern in the Old Testament, and it occurs over and over again. The other thing we see in this chapter is justice is a key word. It occurs several times. It's also the word that's translated rights. So we have justice or rights. And Noah back there is going to tell us what the Hebrew word for that is.
Mishpat?
Mishpat, very good. See? Noah's in my Hebrew class, so I got it. So, very good, Noah. See, you were taught well. Okay, they're perverting justice. Well, justice or rights, and it's the same word in Hebrew. The rights of a king are going to come up here later on. So they're perverting mishpat, and it's the mishpat of the king's rights. So justice and rights are the same word, and it becomes kind of a theme word in this chapter. And it occurs elsewhere in verses 9 and 11. What we see here is Samuel has the same weakness as Eli. It's a weakness that revolves around his sons and his failure to supervise them. Eli didn't do it, that was a judgment. There was a judgment on Eli because he didn't do it. Now Samuel doesn't do it, and we're going to see it leads to some disappointment for Samuel.
Is that because he wasn't home enough? Honestly.
But his sons are down in Beersheba.
No, I mean when they were growing up.
Well, it could have been.
He didn't have the...
It could have been, you know. It's hard to say because we're not given a lot of insight into that.
Successful people often neglect their family.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's true.
And they went off to one of these liberal universities.
That's it. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. UBS, University of Beersheba, right? Let's read 4 through 9 and see how this plays out for Samuel.
So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this displeased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord, and the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king, as they have done from the day I brought them out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods. So they are doing to you. Now listen to them, but warn them solemnly and let them know what the king who will reign over them will do."
Yeah. What the king will reign over them will do. That's, in Hebrew, the rights of the king. And this theme word that occurs in this chapter. So notice, Samuel feels rejected here. God knows that. He says, don't take it personally, Samuel, right? But he feels rejected when they say, "Give us a king."
That means you're rejecting my kids and everything.
Yes, me, my kids, he takes it personally. And God says to him, don't take it personally. They've been doing that to me for a long time. You know? Ever since I brought them up out of Egypt. Right, so we're at, I think, approximately 1049 BC, so we're about 400 years after the Exodus. They've been doing that to me for 400 years, Samuel. It's not about you, Samuel. Not at all. Okay. They rejected God, and therefore they want a king. God was supposed to be the king. God makes that clear here. They've rejected me as king. And the judges were simply kind of regents who did the things that God wanted done, and God was the king. Okay. And notice, Israel wanted to be like the nations, and God had anticipated this. If you go to Deuteronomy 17, God says, you know, you're going to ask for a king like the nations. 400 years earlier, Moses, before he dies, says, God knows this. You're going to ask for a king. And when you get a king, here's the rules, Moses said. And so back in Deuteronomy already, this is anticipated, that Israel will have a king. Doesn't take God by surprise. He knew it was coming all along. But we want to be like the nations. Now that is another key concept here in this chapter. The problem with Israel is already they've been too much like the nations, right? They were worshiping the gods of the nations. And it's almost ironic when they come and say, give us a king like the nations. Well, that's been your problem all along, is you've been trying to be too much like the nations. But they don't see it. And that's what they want. And God says, give them what they ask for. It's not that it was against God's will for them to have a king. Obviously, if he talked about in Deuteronomy and he anticipated they're doing it, it was God's will at some point they're going to have a king. God allows their request. It may not have been the timing he would have chosen for Israel, but nevertheless, God says, okay, give them a king. Let's read, well, before we go on, any questions on those verses before we go to 10 through 22? Yeah.
So Samuel saw that his sons were corrupt, and the people say, this is a problem. So they try to solve the problem themselves and say, we want a king. So what do you think about God's response of, well, giving a king, as opposed to, I'll solve this problem specifically?
Well, God, in some ways, is a realist. He knows that it's going to come to this sooner or later anyway, and he allows it. It's not that it's necessarily the ideal way, but God does this in several of his commandments back in Exodus. So he allows, for instance, for divorce in the laws of Moses, right? Now we get to the New Testament and people come to Jesus and say, well, can a man divorce his wife for any reason? You know, because if you read the Pentateuch, you could read it that way. And Jesus talks about that. And what's he say? For the hardness of your hearts, Moses gave you this commandment. God knew it wasn't his will that you divorce your wives, right? But God knew that it was going to happen. So he's kind of a realist. I would argue the same thing with laws about slavery. There's laws about slavery in the Old Testament, but I think if you read them closely, you get the idea that this isn't God's preferred way of doing things, that one person owns another. So what's he do? He puts limits on it. If you buy a Hebrew slave, he only owes you 7 years of service. Then he goes free. And there's other regulations on it, right? So sometimes God is a realist in the sense that he understands what human sin is about. And he understands that humans are going to do it whether he likes it or not. And so what he does is he tries to put limits on it so too many people don't get hurt. Okay? Knowing that people are going to get hurt anyway because that's the way humans are. I think that's the same thing going on with the king here. I think God would soon, they just soon wait for Jesus to show up and be the king. But they're not going to wait for that. So he says, okay, we'll do it this way. Better that than saying no, and God knows that in their sinful desires, they might just go ahead and do it anyway. So this way, he can control it. He can put limits on it. And it's a sign of God's compassion that he understands the depth of sin's hold on human beings and understands that at times he has to put limits on what that sin can do for the good of everyone. That's hard for us to take, but that's the way we are by nature. And so God puts curves around us to keep us from doing too much wrong, too much harm. I think that's what's going on here with the kingdom too. Okay? Other questions? Okay, how are we doing for time? We're out of time. We're not going to do this. We'll come back to this point and read about what Samuel has to tell the people about a king. That's where we'll pick it up next time. Let's close with prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you not only that you were with your people in the past, but also that you wisely used your law to regulate them. We pray, help us to see that your law is not evil, but it is for our good. And help us to see Jesus, who overcame our temptations and failures to keep your law, so that we might, in gratitude, live according to it in joy.